स्लाइड शो में इसको स्लाइड को चलाना है रिकॉर्डिंग
Good morning class. Today we'll start with Law of Ownership 2. This is a revision lecture, so we would quickly go through different kinds of ownership first. Now this is very easy for you because you are already done with the kinds of legal rights. So when it comes to kinds of ownership, we always start with corporeal and incorporeal ownership. Here corporeal ownership is the ownership of material object. So it is the right of ownership to some corporeal property, movable or immovable. Immovable property would include land and buildings and also things attached to the land. Movable property would include things not attached to lands and chattels of all kinds. Incorporeal ownership is the ownership of a right. Examples of incorporeal property are copyright, patent, trademarks, goodwill, etc. Now it happens that the value of the incorporeal property could be far higher than that of corporeal property. For example, goodwill of a business could be much higher or far higher than that of the actual property involved. Now after this we get to trust and beneficial ownership. So trust ownership is what you read in the law of trusts. This is an instance of duplicate ownership. So trust property is that which is owned by two persons at the same time. The relation between the two owners being such that one of them is under the obligation to use his ownership for the benefit of other. The former is called the trustee and his ownership is trust ownership. And the latter is called the beneficiary and his ownership is called beneficial ownership. The ownership of trustee is in fact nominal and not real. In law, however, the trustee represents his beneficiary. Thus, if property is given to A on trust for B, A would be the trustee and B would be the beneficiary or the cestuary co-trust. So, A would be the legal owner of the property and B the beneficial owner. Now, A would be under an obligation to use the property only for the benefit of B. Now, here the nature of the right of a trustee and beneficiary in the trust property is very distinct. The trustee is destitute of any kind of beneficial enjoyment of trust property. His ownership is a matter of form rather than substance and nominal rather than real. So, in legal theory, he is not a mere agent but an owner, but he is a person to whom the property of someone else is fictitiously attributed by the law. To the extent that the rights and powers thus vested in a nominal owner are to be used by him only on behalf and for the behalf of the real owner. Now, as between the trustee and beneficiary, the property belongs to the latter and not the former. But as between the trustee and third persons, the fiction prevails and the trustee is deemed to be the legal owner of such a property. The trustee is clothed with the rights of his beneficiary and is so enabled to represent him in the dealings with the world at large. Now, while you are going through trust and beneficial ownership, you should also go through the difference between trust and bailment, trust and executorship, and trust and contract. They should also be seen. Plus, trust and agency, trust and mortgage. So, these are also differences which you would be learning very soon. Then we read about vested and contingent ownership. See, ownership is either vested or contingent. It is vested when the owner's title is already perfect. It is contingent when the title is imperfect but is capable of being perfect on the fulfillment of some condition. So in the former case, he owns the right absolutely. In the latter, he owns it only conditionally. So if A gives a gift of the car to his son B, the latter will have the vested interest in the car. However, if A gifts the car to B, provided he marries a particular girl X, B's interest is merely contingent. His interest is conditional on the event which may or may not happen. So if he is able to marry X, his interest becomes vested. Now here, insofar as vested interest is concerned, an interest is said to be vested when it is not subject to any condition precedent or when it is to take effect on the happening of an event which is certain. A person takes a vested interest in property when he acquires a property right in it, but the right of enjoyment is only deferred till a future event happens, which event is certain to happen. So if a Hindu widow adopts a son, but there is an agreement postponing the son's estate during the lifetime of the widow, an interest created in favor of the adopted son is vested right. It does not depend upon any condition precedent. It is to take effect on happening of an event which is certain. The adopted son has a present propriety right in the estate, the right of possession and enjoyment being deferred. Therefore, he can transfer the property even during the widow's lifetime. So, this is all about the vested interest. Then comes contingent interest. Now, wherein transfer of property, an interest therein is created in favor of a person to take effect on happening or not happening of an event, which is uncertain event, such a person acquires thereby a contingent interest in the property. So, such interest becomes vested interest on the happening of the event or when the event becomes impossible, as the case may be. A contingent interest is the one in which any of the proprietary interest or in which neither any proprietary interest nor a right of enjoyment is given at present, and both depend upon the uncertain event. So where an estate is bequeathed to A until he shall marry, and after that event to B, B's interest in the bequest is contingent because it depends upon a condition precedent, that is marriage of A, an event which may or may not happen. Now, B has at present no proprietary interest in the estate and he cannot alienate it. But as soon as A marries, the contingent interest of B becomes vested interest because of the happening of the event on which it was long contingent. Now, there are three things which you should need to know when it comes to contingent interest. A contingent interest is solely dependent upon fulfillment of a condition. So that in case of non-fulfillment, the interest may fall through. Number two, if the transferee dies before obtaining obtaining possession, the contingent interest fails and the property reverts to the transferor, and it is neither transferable nor heritable. Now, when you go through these things, you get to hear again and again about condition precedent and condition subsequent. So this is what you need to know of. Now, a condition is a provision which makes the existence of a right dependent on happening or non-happening of a thing. These could be of three kinds: condition precedent, condition subsequent, and condition limitation. Now, condition precedent is the one which delays the vesting of a right until happening of an event. So a gift of a house may be made to A provided that he passes the law exam. Now, if he passes the law exam, the gift would take effect. Condition subsequent is also called condition of defiance. It is the one which destroys or diverts the right upon happening of an event. Thus, a gift of a house may be made to A with the condition that if he divorces his wife, the house will revert to the donor. So in such a case, the gift of the house takes effect immediately, and if subsequently A divorces his wife, the house will revert to the owner. Then there is condition limitation. Now this is a combination of condition precedent and condition subsequent. It is one containing a condition which diverts an estate that has vested and vests it in another person. As regards to the prior interest, it is a condition subsequent, but as regards to the ulterior interest. So it is a condition precedent. Thus, a gift of house may be made to A with a condition that if he divorces his wife, the house will go to B. It will be seen that as far as A is concerned, it is condition subsequent. That is, he gets the house immediately, subject to be divested if he divorces his wife. However, insofar as B is concerned, it is condition precedent. That is, A has to divorce his wife and then house would rest on him. Then we read of sole ownership and co-ownership. Then we read of legal and equitable ownership. Now, insofar as legal ownership is concerned, it is that which has its origin in rules of common law, and equitable ownership has a origin in rules of equity. Now, ownership which is recognized by law is legal ownership, and the ownership which is recognized by equity is equitable ownership. So, in many cases, it is seen that equity recognizes ownership where law does not, owing to some legal defect. For example, A, the owner of shares in a company, transfers these shares to B, who pays him the amount of consideration. However, a proper transfer deed is required by the rules of the company, but it is not executed. So as a result of which, the company refuses to recognize B as the holder of the shares. In such a case, law may not give any relief to B, as the legal requirements of transfer have not been complied with. However, equity can step in and provide that though A is still the legal owner of the share, he holds it as a trustee for B and must give to B all the dividends and other amounts realized on account of the shares. Then we come to sole ownership and co-ownership. So ordinarily, a right is owned by one person at a time, but duplicate ownership is possible. So two or more persons may have the same right vested in them. Now, this can happen in many manners, but the simplest is co-ownership. So it is undivided unity. Co-ownership may be dissolved into sole ownership of parts by the process called partition. Sole ownership means an exclusive ownership of an individual as against the whole world, and the right arises in case of right to ownership. But in case of the ownership of a right, sole ownership may be the ownership of a bare right of a limited right. Or a limited right. So, for example, limited right of an encumbrance against the right of someone else. Now, in sole ownership, it is only one person who is the owner. But in case of co-ownership or concurrent ownership, two or persons could be there. Now, there's a very common example of co-ownership, that is partners. They are co-owners of the goods and constitute the stock and share of lease and premises where they conduct the business and the debts which the customers owe to them. So if two partners have 10,000 in bank account of their partnership, it means that if there is a debt of 10,000 owing by the bank to both of them and not two separate debts of 5,000 due to each of them individually. Now, co-ownership and joint ownership, this is very important for you because you need to read this in Hindu law again and again. So, co-ownership can assume two forms. It could be ownership in common or joint ownership. So, the most important difference between these relates to the effect of death of one of the co-owners. So, in ownership in common, the right of the dead owner descends to his successors while any other like any other inheritable group. But the death of one or two joint owners, his ownership dies with him and the survivor becomes the sole owner by virtue of right to survivorship. Now there are two different principles of co-ownership, as I said, ownership in common and joint ownership. So, in the first time, on the death of a co-owner, his heirs get the share in the co-ownership. But in the case of joint ownership, the heirs of the deceased joint owner can have no share whatsoever in the right of the deceased in the joint ownership, because with his death, his ownership expires and the surviving joint owner or owners get all that the deceased had in the joint ownership. The right of the survivor or survivors to take away the interest of the deceased joint owner is called right to survivorship. So if a property belongs to A and B in equal shares, and if it is the case of ownership in common, on death of A, half the property will pass to the heirs of A, the other half remaining with B. But if in the same case A and B are joint owners, then B would be entitled to whole property and the heirs of A would get nothing. So this is co-ownership or ownership in common and joint ownership. This is a basic difference which you need to know. Then modes of acquisition of ownership. See, there are basically two modes only. One is called origin acquisition, which can take place in three ways. Absolute is when a thing which is acquired is in fact res nullis, that is, there's no previous owner. Then there is one, this could be occupatio or specificatio. Now, occupatio is also called parigraha by Raja Manu, who said that the first striker of the prey, arrow to the prey, becomes the owner. And specificatio says original ownership of original acquisition of ownership may also be by specificatio, that is, by means of a person, by working up on material belonging of another, belonging to another, making a new thing. For example, a sculptor could come up with a statue from the clay which belongs to a totally different person. Then the person who is a sculptor becomes the true owner. Then there could be extinctive acquisition of ownership. This is when a person by some act on his part extinguishes the ownership of previous owner. So this could be, for example, adverse possession. Then accessio or accessory. So this is called accessory acquisition when ownership of a property is acquired by way of accession to some existing property. So for example, lands or animals or fruits of trees. Then it could be derivative in nature. So when ownership is derived from a previous owner, it is called derivative acquisition of property. So there are many ways, for example, succession, transfer of property, sale of goods, and so on. Then there's one more concept which you need to know really well, and that is the relationship between ownership and possession. Now we have already read that ownership, that possession is 9 points in law, but still you need to have this concept slightly clear. We'll quickly go through it. Now possession as per Ehring is the objective realization of ownership. So it is in fact the ownership. It is in fact what is what ownership is in the right. So possession, whether of a thing or an interest or a right, is the de facto exercise of a claim, whereas ownership is the de jure recognition of the claim. So ownership is a guarantee of the law. Possession is a guarantee of fact. So possession is a de facto counterpart of ownership. It is the external form in which rightful claims normally manifest themselves. So this is what was stated by Ehring. So by ownership in law, what is meant is right of an individual or a body, corporate or incorporate, to possess a thing to the exclusive use of it, or alienate it, or even destroy it in such a manner that he does not disturb the right of others. Which means ownership in the strict sense of term may be defined as right to the enjoyment of the uses of subject matter, with a right to deal with the same in the manner which has been stated. So, for example, if A is the owner of a motor car, he can either use it or he can lock it and put it in the garage. Or he may use it every day or sparingly, or he may exclude strangers or outsiders from doing it. He can gift it to anybody. He can destroy it if he so desires. In short, he has the exclusive dominion over the motor car. Now, insofar as Pollock is concerned, he says ownership may be described as the entirety of the powers of use and disposal allowed by the law. So the owner of a thing is not necessarily the person who at any given point of time has the whole power or use of use or disposal. Now very often there is no such person. So we must look at the person having the residue of all such powers when we have accounted for every detached and limited portion of it, and he will be the owner even if the immediate power or control and user is elsewhere. So in the widest sense, as Salman said, that ownership is the relationship between a person and a right that is vested in him. So Salman says, a thing is owned by me when my claim to it is maintained by the will of the state as expressed by the law. It is possessed by me when the claim to it is maintained by my own self-assertive will. So ownership is the guarantee of the law, possession is the guarantee of fact, or possession is the de facto counterpart of ownership. So with this, I end this lecture. So if you need any clarity on any point, please do get back to me. Thank you.